Thank you very much. Merci. What? Yeah, yeah. Okay, so we're going to get started. There's still people coming in, but we're going to get started. And there's also a number of seats over on this side. Don't be shy. So, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. Bonsoir. Kwe kakina. My name is Stan Leinwand, and I am a senior planner at the National Capital Commission and coordinator of the programming for the Urbanism Lab. So we'd like to welcome, bienvenue, to the Urbanism Lab tonight, to all of the people here, donc aux personnes présentes ici ce soir, et à celles qui regardent la web diffusion en direct sur YouTube. This week, the Capital has been hosting an excellent conference, the International Making Cities Livable Conference, that has attracted people from around the world. They've been talking about how we can make our cities more livable in the 21st century. One way of defining livability is the concept of the 10-minute neighborhood, which is also the theme of this week's conference. So what is the 10-minute neighborhood? The 10-minute neighborhood is a pedestrian-friendly place where almost everything you need is within a short walk or bike ride from your home. A grocery store, a pharmacy, a coffee shop, a corner pub, green spaces, community centers for recreation and other events, and all within an easy walk to public transit. Les intervenants disent que de tels quartiers à usage mixte sont plus durables du point de vue écologique, qu'ils favorisent un mode de vie plus sain et qu'ils sont plus dynamiques et plus branchés. Ils disent qu'ils sont le fondement des collectivités plus solides. Many of these ideas are contained in the plan for Canada's capital, 2017 to 2067, which encourages the development of such neighborhoods in the capital, and in particular, the integration of federal government campuses into the urban fabric that surrounds them. These federal campuses emerged from the Grébert plan for the capital, a plan conceived in an era when the automobile was ascendant, when the car was king. But this is now. Tunney's Pasture, in particular, will be the terminus of the new Confederation Light Rail Line, Phase 1, when it begins service later this year. The site will be a major hub in the public transit system of the future. While researching this topic for the lab, I came across an article from December 2017 in fastcodesign.com. It was entitled, Seven Trends That Augur the Future of Urban Design. One of those seven trends was that corporate campuses will shed their 20th century roots. The article bemoaned that the world's most innovative companies are stuck in their 20th century campuses, isolated from the rest of the cities and communities that they live and work in. So apparently, we're not alone in being interested in this topic. And tonight, we are thrilled to have a pair of very special guests with us to discuss this subject. Vance Bedore has spent more than 30 years as an urban planner, with more than half of that time spent as a principal portfolio planner with the Real Property Branch of Public Services and Procurement Canada. Il a une grande expérience et un grand savoir-faire en matière de direction d'équipes pluridisciplinaires qui élaborent des stratégies et des plans d'urbanisme et des managements à grande échelle. In fact, he was the leader of the team that developed the current master plan for Tunney's Pasture, an award-winning 25-year vision that paves the way for the transformation we hope to achieve in the years to come. Benjamin Grant is the Urban Design Policy Director at the San Francisco Bay Area Planning and Urban Research Association, better known by its acronym SPUR. As a planning and design policy expert, he led SPUR's research that culminated in the 2013 report, Getting to Great Places, which examined how to transform suburban communities into walkable neighborhoods. Et à titre de conservateur, il a créé l'exposition Agents of Change, une étude historique de l'urbanisme à San Francisco. He is also a teacher, a public speaker and commentator who has given extensive thought to the challenges surrounding corporate campuses and how to better integrate them into the community. Thank you both for joining us tonight, and without further ado, we're going to start. So I'd like to call up Ben.
Thank you, Stan. I'd like to thank Stanley and the National Capital Commission for inviting me here. It's my first trip to Ottawa, and I have really enjoyed it. It's a beautiful city, as well as a terrific conference. So, and those of you who've spent all day in the conference, you are truly impressive to now be here. So I want to talk about a few different projects that touch on this question of converting the built environment of the 20th century into the built environment of the 21st century. And the second of which, Rethinking the Corporate Campus, really focuses specifically on employment centers, but in, as you will hear, a very different context. So I think that a good deal of this work will be directly relevant to the challenges that you're facing here, and some of it will also be completely inapplicable, but hopefully interesting by contrast. I work for SPUR, which is a nonprofit, member-supported organization. We promote good planning and good government through research, education, and advocacy. We do a lot of basic research into policy questions that touch on the built environment, urbanism, transportation, climate, housing, et cetera. And we also have a robust program of public engagement through forums like this, and tours, and so forth. So in some ways, this feels like home. SPUR works in three cities in the San Francisco Bay Area. We've been in San Francisco in one form or another for over a century. We were started as a tenement reform organization in the reconstruction after the 1906 earthquake. But San Francisco represents only 11% of the population of the Bay Area region. And the problems of San Francisco look quite different from the planning and transportation problems facing the Bay Area as a whole, particularly as the center of economic gravity has moved south to the Silicon Valley. So some years ago, we decided to approach these regional questions by working out of the three center cities. Especially working at the local level, which in the Bay Area context is where much of the decision-making around land use and growth take place. So we opened in San Jose in 2009 and then in Oakland in 2015. So we approached this urban design guidebook for San Jose as our first major study out of that San Jose office, where we felt like the major challenge that that city needed to address was retooling its post-war suburban environment to create the kinds of walkable, dense, mixed places that are more sustainable, easier served by public transportation, and also the city's stated goal. And in order to do that, we approached San Jose with this paradox. And San Jose, I should say, by way of background, is the largest city by population and geography in the Bay Area, but is primarily grew by the agglomeration of suburban communities. So it has a fairly auto-dependent character. And having built a lot of housing in the last 30 years and not gotten as many jobs, which because of the peculiarities of the tax structure in California, housing is very fiscally punishing, and local communities often try to attract jobs over housing. So San Jose was working very hard to try to attract more jobs to get a more balanced land use portfolio. We're all for housing and jobs. But a lot of the way we framed this work was around understanding employers and where they might want to locate. And we start with this paradox that Silicon Valley, the most dynamic and innovative economic engine in the world, is not creating great places. In fact, most of the Silicon Valley environment, and I will show you some images of that, are utterly forgettable, if not offensive, as places. In fact, it's not an uncommon sight to see tourists standing in the median of a suburban arterial with traffic whizzing by, trying to take a picture of the pedestal sign outside of Facebook or Google, because trying to figure out where Silicon Valley is and what it looks like is a real challenge. But increasingly, the talent that these companies are fighting over are demanding engaging places. They're demanding mixture. They're demanding amenities. In short, they're demanding urbanism. So this paradox of the most innovative companies in the world creating very uninspired places was sort of our point of entry to this work. How do we get from this kind of environment? This is North San Jose in front of Cisco, a major tech firm that's of a somewhat earlier generation, to environments that look more like this, which was recently constructed at the Bay Meadows Caltrain station in San Mateo, a little ways up the San Francisco Peninsula, and has successfully combined tech-oriented office space at a transit station with housing, retail, and open space amenities at a very impressive level of design and implementation. One of the things we started with is trying to explain what we meant by urban design. And this was our working definition, because very often, particularly in communities that have not had a strong internal design capacity or a strong tradition of urban form, there's some question about what that term means. In fact, if you work in urban design, you know that even within the field of urban design, there are a lot of questions about what that term means. And it means different things to different people. It takes in landscape architecture, it takes in development, it takes in physical planning, land use, transportation, and so forth. But we settle on this as our working definition: the integration of buildings, streets, and open spaces into places that work for people. Seems simple, right? Anybody that has tried to execute this in an environment that was designed around a different set of priorities, namely the automobile in the 20th century, knows just how difficult that can be. So we started with a set of basic principles, and these will, any of you who work in the planning field, these will be familiar as just basic tenets of city building, so I won't dwell on them, but just very quickly, fine-grained pedestrian network of routes, orienting buildings to streets and open spaces to give them a spatial definition and meet the street. Organizing uses to support public activity, thinking about where retail goes, where density goes, and where dead uses like parking go as well. Placing parking behind and below buildings. One of the chief features of the suburban environment is the prevalence of parking as often the primary land use and certainly the primary form giver. So trying to tackle that. Addressing the human scale with building and landscape detail. Much of the auto-oriented environments are designed to be seen at high speed, and so not a lot of consideration is given to the human scale. And finally, second to last, continuous comfortable pedestrian realm, which means how generous is it? How comfortable is it? Do sidewalks end at the end of a particular development because they are associated with that development as opposed to being the fabric of the city themselves? And finally, and this is an area where I think we've made some progress in the California context, is building complete streets that are not designed simply to move traffic, but as places for different modes of travel and places for gathering and commerce and civic life as well. And reminding folks that even if you do drive, this is not about being punitive to drivers. Everyone is a pedestrian, even if they get someplace by car. And if we can get people in the South Bay, which is an overwhelmingly suburban environment in the Bay Area, to go someplace where they park their car once and do a variety of things, even if that trip is made by car, we've just saved several other trips, and it would constitute significant progress. So what's so hard about this? Seems like good basic urban design principles, right? We see them in many of our older cities. Shouldn't be that hard. Well, it turns out that everything is hard about this. We have spent the last 75 years, certainly in the United States, but I think throughout North America and to some degree throughout the world, developing the professions associated with city building around a different set of priorities. And hence, to undo that is not simply a matter of understanding what you'd like to achieve and showing a pretty picture of it. You have to tackle a variety of different impediments in the technical fields, in transportation planning, in firefighting, in street standards, in parking ratios, in the financial services sector, the people that finance these projects and expect them to look like comparable projects that have been built before. In some places, soft markets, where there's not a lot of market interest in the kind of world you're trying to create, so putting it down on paper doesn't necessarily get the job done. So all of these things add up to a very multi-headed hydra of challenges that need to be tackled before we can actually see changes to the built environment on the ground. And the typical pattern, even in places like San Jose, that has stated in its policies that it wants to become a denser more urban, more walkable, more transit-oriented community, that until you pick apart one at a time the standards and practices and culture of how cities are made, you can't get the job done. So that is kind of prologue in a way. That is the Getting to Great Places report that Stanley mentioned in the introduction. On the heels of that work, and I also use that to kind of give you a sense of our goals in tackling the workplace, we started a couple of years ago working on a project called Rethinking the Corporate Campus. And this happened to coincide with a tremendous economic boom that has been going on in the Bay Area for the past 5, 6, 7 years, and of course on the heels of several cycles of boom and bust, driven by the knowledge sector or the innovation sector, namely tech, but not exclusively so. So in thinking about the suburban workplace, which is really what we want to try to tackle, because the Bay Area is really struggling under the weight of an environment that doesn't meet the goals we're trying to achieve, we can go back to the post-war period and look at some of the principles that drove jobs out into suburban communities, certainly the same forces at work here in the capital. This is Bell Labs in Holmdel, actually a spectacularly beautiful building by Eero Saarinen that really epitomized the idea of this kind of cloistered environment where intellectuals would go and do advanced research to create new technology, isolated from the city and kind of a protected world of its own. But actually, this makes a very bad template for Silicon Valley. This is not what Silicon Valley looks like. Oh, and I should just say, by way of transition, Silicon Valley grew up a very different culture. And in fact, a lot of this kind of single-use finished campuses were built in the Northeast. Very few of these were built on the West Coast. And in some of the literature around Silicon Valley and how it was so successful, and there is a ton of that literature because everyone wants to be Silicon Valley. It's kind of exhausting, actually. A lot of that literature focuses on this culture of startups, of splitting off, of leaving institutions quickly, taking your knowledge with you, starting a new company, riding that for a little while, breaking up again. And this, the template was set by a group called the Traitorous Eight, who left Shockley Semiconductor to found Fairchild Semiconductor. In the mid-1950s, and it was scandalous that they would do this at this time, and that pattern continued, where that group of people then broke off and started other companies, who broke off and started other companies. And a very large cultural contrast to the typical hierarchical company man, stay with your corporation for 40 years and then retire, that was prevalent at the time. So this culture has a spatial expression, and that is this. I can hear the planners in the room groaning. I can see the furrowed brows. It's a hot mess from a planning point of view. If you've ever seen the HBO program Silicon Valley, the opening credits are a wonderful sort of spoof of this as a cartoon. But what's interesting about this landscape, although it is an absolute catastrophe from a transportation, sustainability, placemaking, walkability point of view, it has one very significant virtue, which is that it is a modular environment consisting of a set of one or two tilt-up 2- and 3-story buildings, very cheaply constructed with large floor plates surrounded by surface parking at a rate of 3 or 4 spaces per 1,000 square feet. That is a totally predictable module, and what that means is that if you are one of those tech companies that has been funded by venture capital and you're growing a mile a minute, you can snap these up as a very predictable product, and you know exactly what you're getting. You'll be able to get it quickly, and when you start to tank and you need to start unloading your real estate holdings, the same holds true. So it's very predictable, it's very stable, and it's also very hard to change because of the expectations that this kind of place as liquid asset is so prevalent in Silicon Valley. This module has changed a little bit in that as property values have gone higher and higher in the current boom, it is getting denser, but it is still the same basic approach, where you have now a 6, 7, 8-story building and a parking garage associated with it, which is the new commodity. When you scale this up to the scale of the largest innovation sector economy in the world, you get something that looks a little more like this. And the shortcomings from the sustainability and transportation standpoint become vividly clear. This is an environment that cannot be served with public transit in any effective way because it is too low density and it has no center. It is also very difficult to get around by any other means because it is not very walkable. It's not very bikeable, with a few exceptions. Even the automotive apparatus infrastructure that supports it has now reached thresholds where it can no longer accommodate additional growth. So you have a situation where you can't get there by car or any other means. You still have an enormous economic engine cranking this out, but we don't have the capacity in our automotive infrastructure to support it. Our freeways are clogged, our arterials are clogged. As a discipline, planning has started to move away from that way of building anyway. So we're at a little bit of an impasse, and it is to the point where there's very real concerns that this will sort of kill the golden goose, that our economic engine sometimes feels too hot, but better that than the reverse, and we become Detroit. Although kudos to Detroit, which is bouncing back in an extraordinary way, but that's the parable, right? So we set out, Spur set out to understand first and foremost how this landscape works, what the private sector actors are and how they behave, how the landscape of employment centers in the Bay Area is changing or not. So doing a lot of analysis and then analyzing the performance of different employment centers on matters that are important to planners. How many jobs, how do they get to work, how walkable is it, et cetera, and I'll show you some of those. So we wanted to understand how employers in the innovation economy make decisions about two things: workplace location, where are they going, and workplace form, what are they building when they get there. We want to recommend useful and achievable best practices for both employers and policymakers. And we want to improve the performance of a wide range of workplaces with respect to our policy agenda, which essentially is a smart growth, sustainability-driven urban agenda. Sketched out here, none of these will surprise you, I'm sure. Support a thriving, resilient economy, make efficient use of land, reduce drive-alone commuting, reduce greenhouse gas emissions, support the Bay Area's unique quality of life. And there is a cultural moment that is taking place in the Bay Area with a combination of the transportation crisis and the housing crisis, where costs are going up to astronomical levels. There's a moment in the Bay Area where the culture of the place feels under siege, and people are feeling a great deal of anxiety about what the future will bring and whether it will continue to be the special place that it has been for the past 50, 75 years. Some of the pressures we're talking about: auto dependency and congestion, high housing costs, which is challenging in itself, but also places incredible upward pressure on wages. So companies are actually having trouble hiring, because to bring someone to the San Francisco Bay Area, say a software engineer, you have to pay them an inordinate sum of money to live there. It becomes very expensive, and people won't move there if they're going to have to live in a bunk bed when they make $150,000 a year. High commercial rents threatening the kind of startup culture and innovation ecosystem at the small level that has long been credited with the sort of bubbling up to create these much larger companies. The shift back towards an urban environment in the culture, so the generational preference of the younger workers who want to live in an urban environment, who are driving up the cost of urban environments because we don't have very many of them in the Bay Area. We stopped building them in 1930, and most of the region grew in the post-war suburban boom. And then finally, and implicit in some of what I've been saying, national and international leakage. Increasingly, companies in this sector don't hire in the Bay Area if they can possibly help it. So these big giants, Facebook and Google and LinkedIn, companies like that, any job that they can hire in Austin, Denver, Nashville, Ottawa, they will do that. Because the quality of life for their employees is higher. The talent pool in those other centers is building in capacity and able to do increasingly advanced work for these companies. And so they're hiring only the sort of creme de la creme locally in the Bay Area, because the cost is so high to bring people there. And it's becoming a huge challenge for them. We focused on innovation sector jobs simply for the reason that that is our leading industry. That's where the job growth has overwhelmingly been in the last 10, 15 years, actually going back even farther, 20 years. And looked at where the sort of new wave of employment was locating. So this is looking at the location of jobs relative to transit, and that's a little bit hard to read, so I'll skip to the summary slide. Only 26% of new jobs are in transit proximate locations, within half a mile of regional rail. If you notice the blue column there, that column represents the city of San Francisco, which is a dramatic exception to the density and form of the rest of the region. It's a traditional urban form. It's quite walkable, relatively speaking, and it's well served by transit. So if you remove San Francisco from this equation, 91% of the jobs in the Bay Area have gone in areas that are not well served by transit. So the upshot is we are not solving this problem. We are not moving the needle, even with a big boom, which in principle would allow us to start channeling investment into kind of transformative projects in both the public and the private sector. We're not moving the needle on mode share. This is commute to work data. The orange, drive alone commuting. So this is some of those employment center statistics that also shine a light on the way people get around and the way the physical form and land use mix contributes to people's behavior. This is downtown San Francisco with a walk score of 95. The drive alone employment rate is 24%. In the subset of this that represents the core of the financial district, it's 80% arrivals by transit. So this is sort of our poster child, not because San Francisco has better planners. It's just that through an accident of history, San Francisco developed on a traditional dense urban form and has successfully channeled growth and transit through the downtown core since the 1960s. Contrast that with North Bay Shore, home of Google and LinkedIn. This is in the city of Mountain View. Walk score of 40, drive alone rate of 75%. North San Jose, that first image I showed you where Cisco is, walk score of 38, and employee drive alone rate of 84%. So the Bay Area has this reputation of being this cutting edge, progressive region, and in certain respects we are, but when it comes to placemaking and then when it comes to sustainable development, we're doing a very poor job indeed. So we really wanted to understand this from the private sector side. We spend a lot of time lobbying on the public sector for better planning policy, better transportation policy, et cetera. That's kind of our typical MO. But in this case, it seemed like there was a mismatch because lots of planners were saying all the right things about what kind of places they wanted to create. But as I just showed you, the changes are not coming quickly enough. So we wanted to understand this from the private sector side and figure out where that mismatch is. And I think this is something that planners need to do more of. This is something I've been guilty of myself in my career, is sort of assuming that we know better, that we have the answers. And I think we do have the answers to things like what makes a walkable community, but we don't necessarily have the answers about why a company whose primary business is thinking about anything other than city planning would make the choices that they make that actually shape the built environment so profoundly. So we interviewed many dozens of developers, of employers, also planners and public sector folks, and these are the four factors that floated to the top of the pile as drivers of decisions for employers' location, where they're going to go, and form, what they're going to build. The first, and these, by the way, these came up in virtually every conversation we had, so we quickly isolated them as key things to understand, and they explain a lot. Talent acquisition and retention. They talk about this as a war for talent all the time. They are constantly poaching each other's people. There is a huge but nevertheless limited pool of technical talent in the Bay Area, and these companies are constantly trying to outcompete one another to land them. And this drives a lot of different things. This has driven many companies to locate in urban centers, and that's a real change from earlier eras. You now have major companies like Salesforce, Twitter, Yelp in downtown San Francisco, which used to be considered impossible. A tech company would never go into a vertical format office building, and that has changed. Other companies who feel for a variety of reasons that they don't want to be in a downtown location have had to go into the transportation business, have become transit operators. So many of you have probably heard of the Google buses and the controversies around those. Well, that is an attempt to bus their talent from the urban communities where they want to live to the suburban headquarters where they're needed. And that is really about securing the talent. And we heard people say that, heard employers say that it's not uncommon now in a job interview for these companies for the prospective employee to say, how are you going to get me to work? Which is an amazing turnabout. I would not think to say that in a job interview. Providing transportation, but also providing all kinds of on-site amenities, whether it's free lunch, doggy daycare, haircuts, dry cleaning, all kinds of amenities, many of which sound like sort of preposterous or silly goodies. They're partially just about luring people with goodies, but they're also partially about the fact that these workplaces are in very isolated environments. So if someone needs to get a haircut or drop off their dry cleaning, they need to get in a car at lunchtime, and you have traffic jams at lunchtime in big parts of the Bay Area as people are trying to do basic services. So there's been a kind of arms race in amenities driven by both the spatial pattern and the trying to outcompete one another for talent. Number two is growth and exit strategy. So that modular landscape that I was talking about a very predictable module of parking and building, is really a creature of growth and exit strategy. These companies grow very fast when they grow. They want to be able to gobble up land and buildings very quickly without thinking about it too much. As one person put it, Silicon Valley was designed to put butts in chairs quickly, and now we have to live with the sort of hangover from that. And to this day, even the more urban examples of these campuses are very carefully designed to be able to be subdivided and sold off as an exit strategy. And that affects a lot of parameters of the physical conditions and the way the sites are organized. Number three, large floor plates. This is something of a cult in the mythos of Silicon Valley. From the days of Hewlett-Packard, when the CEO would walk through the large open floor plate, they called it management by walking around. And the idea that these big flexible spaces could be rapidly reconfigured for teams, that nobody had to get on an elevator, as one person put it to me, the minute you have to decide whether or not to get on an elevator is the minute you don't. So even the companies that are locating in vertical office buildings downtown, they have decided that they're not going to let this drive everything, but they're still very preoccupied with it. They're in there punching stairs through, thinking a lot about vertical circulation, because this idea of how teams are organized in space is central to the kind of culture of these companies, whether you agree with it or not. And the most extreme example is the recent Facebook expansion by Frank Gehry, 430,000 square feet in a single room. The entire usable office space is one room. Huge. The entire ground floor is parking. The entire top floor is a private park for the use of the workers. So that's this obsession taken to its extreme, but every company in this sector is thinking about it. And then finally, intellectual property security. Okay, these companies, their lifeblood is their competitive advantage of their intellectual property. They're constantly spying on each other. They're constantly losing people to go to other companies, and there's big litigation between Uber and Google right now over the self-driving car software. There's, you know, it's a world of non-disclosure agreements, and you know, it's very intense. Now, there are different ways to approach this question, right? The traditional way has been to isolate yourself in a remote environment that is very inward-looking. And you know, that has the added benefit of being able to keep people on campus and working all the time. All of these things are factors that are driving these companies. We don't have to agree that these things are super important, but it's kind of none of our business, right? As planners, we know about planning. Now, some of these things may seem a little bit silly to us, but if planners and urban designers don't learn how to meet these needs or accommodate these priorities in a successful built environment, we will simply not be successful at changing the nature of the built environment. I'm going to wrap up pretty soon, but I just want to show some images. And if you keep these ideas, these four concepts in mind as you see these images, they explain a lot about that built environment. This is Cisco. This is about 1/6 of the Cisco campus in North San Jose, of identical buildings with their modules of surface parking. Interestingly, Cisco, as it has kind of matured and started to decline as a company, has demonstrated successfully the exit strategy baked into this. They are selling off components of this one piece at a time. Not so successful from an urban design point of view, to put it mildly. That arterial running through the middle has light rail transit running up it, one of the least performing light rail transit systems in North America, and you can see why. The land use is simply not there to support it. This is the famous slash infamous Apple spaceship. I should swap out a newer picture because it is now complete. This is often cited as sort of the last gasp of a different era of the suburban corporate campus, but because Steve Jobs came up with this concept in the waning days of his life, it has sort of become an article of faith that in the company that they had to build it. But it is a completely isolated environment. I think it's something like 5 million square feet, 11,000 parking spaces, not near transit of any sort. So completely isolated. And even though they could accommodate all these cars on their campus, the arterials and freeways leading to this campus are hopelessly congested. And this is sort of widely cited as what not to do, even though it's a very sexy looking building if you've seen the renderings. Facebook is another interesting case study. This is the former Sun Microsystems campus. And re-inhabited hermit crab style by Facebook. That central spine up the middle of the buildings was rebuilt by Facebook as an imaginary city street, sort of a la Disney. So they have a brew pub and a haircut place and a bike shop and all that, exclusive to the employees of the company. So you see this like weird competing impulses where the people that work there, the image that resonates for them is a city street, but the company that built this and the company that then inhabited it subsequently clearly wants to turn very powerfully away from everything that surrounds it and look inward to create an insular corporate culture. So it's a very, very revealing look into the thinking over time. This is Google, another re-inhabitation. And by the way, both of these are examples of a trend, both Facebook and Google, of moving away from that disposable landscape of just tilt-up buildings and parking. That started to happen in the 90s, where a few of the top companies started to do more finished, more sort of architecturally significant projects, headquarters for themselves that wanted to be seen. I mean, those other buildings, you know, they're designed not to be seen. And that's a real shift. And the funny thing is, these are just as car dependent as the other ones, and they give up the one virtue of that environment, which is that total flexibility to grow and shrink quickly. What happens when Apple shrinks? It's going to be pretty hard to lease off a part of the spaceship. As I mentioned, Yelp in downtown San Francisco in an old skyscraper, wonderful Timothy Pfluger building from 1929. On the other hand, Yelp's business is information about the city, right? So culturally, it makes a lot of sense for them. And compared to companies that do hardware other kinds of size of the industry, social media and sort of urban-oriented companies are much more likely to be willing to locate downtown. This was going to be Uber. They have since shrunk out of it. This is downtown Oakland. Interesting example of an old building type. This was a Sears that is very attractive because of the large floor plates. So certain types of older buildings, warehouses, department stores, and so forth, offer something that appeals to these companies. And I think especially as Uber, they're willing to forego a whole lot of parking since their whole model is about something different. I think the most interesting ones are the kind of hybrid examples where they're starting to change, starting to solve for these things even in more suburban environments because they point the way forward if we can get their approaches adopted at scale. One of the most interesting ones is Box, which is located in downtown Redwood City, immediately adjacent to a commuter rail station, a Caltrain station. They have tried to come to an accommodation between their needs as a tech company and the downtown's needs, and they Redwood City has a very strong planning department with very clear physical planning standards. All the parking is underground. There's the building really meets the street well. It's right on top of a rail station. But then you have these two fairly large floor plate buildings, fairly bulky buildings, and the 2 second floors, as you can see, are joined by an amenity deck and hence can be leased as a continuous floor plate, effectively. And so that was sort of the concept here, and it's been very successful. It's one of the only tech workplaces where, outside of San Francisco, where you can go and you can watch 150 people get off a train and walk up into their offices. It's virtually unheard of, and it's very much the exception, unfortunately. There are only a couple of these. We on time? Okay, we're going to wrap it up here. This is Samsung North San Jose. Samsung leaned into the vision of urbanizing and densifying North San Jose. I don't think it occurred to them to resist that, although, you know, many of the other local developers and companies wanted to keep it the old way. They just went ahead and went for it and did a very successful urban format building. And then finally, this is the one I showed you first, which is Bay Meadows around the Caltrain station in San Mateo. So we have a whole series of recommendations for how to kind of push these transformations farther. They're aimed both at the private sector and the public sector. I'm happy to talk through more of those, but at this point, I think in the interest of time, I should hold it there. Thank you very much.
Good evening, everyone. I'd like to offer a warm welcome to all the delegates who are here for the conference. Can you raise your hands if you're with the conference? Great to see. Excellent. Certainly, I hope you've enjoyed our capital. I would like to see you bring your friends and family back to visit us at some point in time. I think it's a great place to live and a great place to work. Over the next 20 minutes or so, I'll try to provide you with an overview of the process undertaken by Public Services and Procurement Canada, that's the federal department that I work for, which will lead the transformation of the largest federal employment node in Canada from a single-purpose use to a transit-oriented mixed-use complete community. And the vision, this is the build-out that I'm showing at the very beginning. The vision for the site is to be realized over the next 25 years. Just to give you a little bit of background in terms of our department is responsible for the office accommodation program. We have over 50% of our real property in the national capital area. We have 3.3 million meters squared of office space, 138 Crown-owned buildings, and 171 private sector buildings that we lease. We accommodate over 110 departments and agencies, and we have approximately 139 full-time employees in the capital. And it represents approximately 20% of the workforce of Ottawa and Gatineau, which is the national capital region. Just a bit of a snapshot of, for those who haven't been to Ottawa or don't know Ottawa very well. You can see on the slide, those are the federal employment nodes. We have about 50% of that workforce in our downtown core in the CBD of Ottawa and Hull. And then we have three nodes out around. The first node is A, which is the Tunney's Pasture that I'll talk about. We have another one to the south, another one to the east. We are very well served by a bus rapid transit system right now, a world-class one, to be honest. And in the fall of this year, we're actually going to implement a new light rail transit system for the city of Ottawa, about a 13-kilometer first segment with 3 kilometers underground. This is the location of Tunney's Pasture. Tunney's Pasture is a major federal government node. It's approximately 3 kilometers from the downtown. It's on a 49-hectare site, and those who don't work in metric, 120 acres of property. It has currently 19 office buildings on it. They were constructed between 1950 and 1970, and they house different federal departments. And any of you who are planners would know the renowned French urban planner, Jacques Gruber, and he incorporated Tunney's Pasture into the plan for Canada's capital. This is Tunney's Pasture today. Offices in the park. That was the vision that Gruber had for this site, and that's exactly the way it is today. It's considered by anybody that works there as a very isolated campus. You could shoot a cannon down the streets anytime after about 4:30 or 5 o'clock in any day. Employees don't really think it's that great a place to work, particularly those young mobile workers. It is served by a bus rapid transit, but it's a very isolated site. There's the bus rapid transit station in red. Just some images quickly of the park, or of the Tunney's Pasture. While it's built on a large boulevard, the site is defined by aging buildings, 10,000 employees, underutilized office or open space. It's got a disconnected grid of oversized streets, blocks, large expanses of surface parking. In fact, I would suggest that the major use of Tunney's Pasture is surface parking. And the second image, in addition, Tunney's today has poor pedestrian and cycling networks. It's very poorly connected to the adjacent communities at the same time. So for a number of reasons, but the federal government wanted to modernize its workplace. It was called at the time Workplace 2.0. The City of Ottawa plans to develop LRT. That all came together and we decided to go forward with a new master plan for Tunney's Pasture. The process began in 2009 and it took about 5 or 6 years to go through that whole process. But we started off with the objectives of the master plan, which you can see in front of you, to create a leading edge employment community, high standards for urban design and planning, focus on transit oriented development and community integration. From a federal perspective, to guide our long-term investment, contribute to the federal image, respect the Gruber legacy, and more efficient use of the site. So we went through, I would suggest it was the first time that PSPC ever went through a public consultation process on any of their lands. We just weren't in that business. We didn't go through public consultation. So we went through an extensive public consultation process. We involved all the community groups. We involved all the federal employees, with the City of Ottawa, every group that we could think of, and all major stakeholders were involved. It ended up with a very close collaboration with the City of Ottawa and very close collaboration with the National Capital Commission, who are also our approval authority in any of the work that we do in land use and design. And it culminated in an approval for this plan in September 16th, 2014. Oops, I'll go back. There's the image of the plan. We worked with a really talented consulting firm, and the project team, after they went through public consultation and stakeholder consultation with a couple of development options, realized there wasn't enough mixed use. It wasn't a really good plan. So we spent about a year working on a preferred concept because of that input, and here's what we come up with in the plan. We've got an urban plaza with the LRT station, which is number one. We certainly have, we've decided we got between 3,400 and 3,700 residential units, so there'll be approximately 9,000 people living in the area. Lots of retail, there'll be ground floor grocery stores, there may be schools. We've certainly integrated it with the community, proposed between 22 and 25,000 federal employees to be on that property over the next 25 years as well. This is just the land use plan, and certainly we had to be very careful in terms of the adjacent community, and I think the determining factor in the success of part of the master plan is just the balance of building and massing and height and density on the site. As you can see from this pattern, in developing the plan, there was certainly a need for a finer grain up streets and more streets. We went through the process of adding extra streets. The property doesn't look like there should be more streets, but there are large buildings that are still there. And if those buildings ever do come down, then we probably will look at changing the grid or the finer grain of streets on that property. But we're contemplating complete streets, because right now cycling and pedestrian routes are not well connected to the city's network and to the NCC's network. So that's what we're going to do, design as a complete street. Next picture is just a rendering of one of the complete streets in the office district of the site that we're proposing. Again, a rendering illustrating the integration of cycling and pedestrian movement on one of the primary routes into our site. And I think, Ben, you certainly mentioned talking about parking. We're going to certainly encourage alternatives to the car and encourage a higher modal split. I think Tunney's Pasture is around 40% presently, but we'll be looking at upwards of probably 70% modal split. We were looking at encouraging from this, you can see in this next illustration, that we'll probably put a couple of layers of underground parking and podium parking. There will be very little surface parking unless it's for accessibility reasons. And we see it as going to downtown standards on this site as well. One of the key features of this plan too is the linear corridors. You can see this is the open space typologies. We have a large community park of a hectare, which will serve the residential and office. We spent a lot of time negotiating the whole open space concept and typologies with the City of Ottawa. They also incorporated this plan into their plan. We have linear parks, we have green roofs, internal courtyards, amenity areas, community parks, and the light rail transit station plaza will be about a half a hectare as well. Here's an image, a rendering of the urban plaza at the new LRT station, and that station should be up and running this fall. And we're looking at putting a number of restaurants and retail commercial services around that plaza. We're starting to look at the design of that right now. And here's the community, just a rendering of the community park that we see, kind of a bird's eye view. And you see a linear park along Sir Frederick Banting that will take you right out to the waterfront lands. The NCC right now are also engaged in a whole riverfront waterfront plan, which will be connected to Tunney's Pasture as well, which is very innovative and very creative from the capitalist perspective. So this is the build out after 25 years, the result of 4 years of consultation, a 25-year vision for Tunney's Pasture as a transit-oriented, sustainable, complete community. The NCC Board of Directors unanimously approved this plan back in 2014. I think Stan had mentioned that it has won a couple of awards and for urban design and community planning. In terms of implementation of this whole master plan, we see it from a federal perspective to guide our federal portfolio investment decisions, provide design input for new construction projects, determine priority for demolition projects. Some of the buildings on that site are old, and we'll have to look at demolishing some of them over the course of the next number of years. Identify what lands are surplus for disposal. Prerequisites to implementing the plan are a whole lot of pre-development studies, infrastructure studies, financing studies. And one of the key things I forgot to mention at the beginning, when you looked at the road network on this plan, they're all owned by the federal government. They are not owned by the city. So technically, it's one block of land with internal streets. We call them driveways, and they're federal. We will have to sit down with the municipality, in discussion to transfer the ownership so that they will be on, those blocks of land will be on public streets, and then we can dispose of the lands which are not residential, or which are not office and are residential, because we as our department are not involved in residential retail, we're only involved in office. There's certainly going to be a need for partnerships with the city, the NCC, private developers, and other stakeholders, and we're going to encourage every partner to use the master plan for their programming, for their planning, and designing their future developments. There may be P3 models, other approaches, none of that has been determined yet. Oops. So this, the master plan is a significant milestone in the Canadian federal government's real estate and planning portfolio. It's one of the largest federal campuses. However, it reaches beyond these milestones and sets an important precedent, we think, for the federal government. And one of the things that I think is very key is this plan, when it's implemented and it's built out over the next 25 years, will really contribute to the vibrancy of the city of Ottawa as well. It's very close to the downtown. It's in a very key location, and I think it will be successfully implemented. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So we're now going to have a period of question and answers. I think we're going to move the podium also. Someone's going to come and move the podium so that everyone can see. We have two microphones set up here for questions. Donc, on a deux microphones pour des questions. Soyez à l'aise de demander vos questions dans la langue de votre choix. And we'll go back and forth, and we'll start with first question over here.
Hi, my name is Adam. I'm with the City of Ottawa, and my questions are mostly transportation related. So for the Bay Area, I've heard that just with talk. A new development, there's a requirement that the developer would show that the trip generation for that development would be half what the existing sort of average trip generation is. And I'm wondering, does that only apply sort of in San Francisco proper, and could that be applied to these corporate campuses?
Oh, there's no on button.
Sorry, while I was messing with the microphone, I missed the very first part of the question.
So I've heard from somewhere that that the city, the municipality, requires a new developer to show that the trip generation of their new development is half whatever the average is for the city. Could that be applied to a campus?
It could, depending on the local jurisdiction. One of the challenges we face in the Bay Area is that we have 101 separate municipal jurisdictions, each of which sets its own policy completely with respect to land use and to a considerable extent with respect to transportation. Our regional planning institutions are fairly weak. So it would take a lot of political will at the local level. And San Francisco has a lot of political will with respect to transportation issues in particular. And they do have a process by which they model the VMT of or trip generation of projects, and the developer has to sort of demonstrate that they're coming in at a lower threshold. And I don't know enough about the specifics of the policy to give you more than that, although I could put you in touch with the right people if you're interested. One thing we call for in the corporate campus report that would be at a regional scale is a commercial VMT fee, which is a similar way of accomplishing the same thing, which basically models what the trip generation will be, and you are subject to a fee based on that impact, the trips you're kind of dropping into the system. So then there's an incentive built into that you would drive down your drive-alone commute rate in order to have a lower fee. And I think that's something that is quite viable and would have some impact.
Thank you. We'll take next question over on this side.
Thanks for your two presentations. Affordable rental on my mind, and I'm just wondering, both in the corporate campus context, because not everybody's earning a six-digit salary, And in the case of Dundee's Pastures, is affordable rental, does it figure in the conversation at all? Is one question, and the part B, if it does, just briefly, how?
I guess it depends on what your definition of affordable housing. Certainly, for those 3,400 to 3,700 residential units that will be there, there will be a mix of housing types, probably from singles to towns to stack to apartment style, condominium. So I think there'll be a diversity of housing, and I would suggest that will add to the affordability index on the property, but none of that has been determined other than that we'd like to see residential development on that site right now. But we're not in the residential business, and it'll be dependent on how that goes forward.
Maybe you can talk about Canada Lands.
We have a development arm at the federal government. It's called Canada Lands Company. And any of the properties that are deemed to be surplus from the office accommodation program, then most of them are turned over to Canada Lands because they're deemed to be surplus to us. Canada Lands then, as a development corporation of the federal government, take those lands. They will upzone them, whatever they have to do. They are also obliged to go through the municipal planning process, and that's where the community gets involved again in terms of what residential units will go on blocks of land and the type and the ownership and all of that. So we see that as one of the vehicles that will determine the affordability and how the residential component of Tunney's Pasture will be developed in the future.
With respect to the Bay Area context, obviously housing costs are exorbitant and getting higher all the time and are at the core of every discussion of planning issues in the Bay Area. We have a very robust nonprofit housing industry that is cranking out housing as quickly as it can, but is nowhere near at the scale to meet the demand that's being generated. So there are constant struggles to find new policy levers to get more affordable housing built and financed. Inclusionary housing, inclusionary zoning that requires a certain percentage of the units to be subsidized to one degree or another is pretty standard in a lot of the major projects, certainly throughout San Francisco and in some of the larger developments elsewhere. But we do not have a model that will generate housing on the scale that will actually tackle the problem that we face. It's enormous and a real crisis.
Thanks.
Next question.
Yes. Oh, thank you both for your presentations. My question is about Tunney's Pasture. So what is the current usage of the buildings there right now as office buildings? Did I miss that already? Did you already say?
No, the majority of the buildings are there are office buildings.
Are they all being used 100% is my question.
I'm not sure, to tell you the truth. I could find you an answer, but I'm on the urban planning side, not the accommodation side, but I would suggest that, and there are different departments in there. Two of the large departments are Stats Canada and Health Canada.
And Health Canada, yeah. Okay.
But, you know, sometimes with people transitioning in and out of different buildings, it's almost like Swiss cheese. And they fill up, and then they, you know. So I'm not sure what the level of accommodation is in each one of those buildings now. But if you're interested, I can certainly try to find out through our accommodation branch for you.
Sure. And I just had a follow-up question. Sure. What percentage will become residential in the new plan? Have you figured that out yet, or just that there will be residential?
I can't tell you the exact portion of the site that will be residential. But almost the whole western section of the site will be residential, and we're proposing between 3,400 and 3,700 residential units, which will probably be around 9,000 people on the site.
Okay, great. Thank you.
And 22,000 to 25,000 federal employees at full build-out, and lots of retail as well on the site. So should be a fairly complete community and a fairly dense
community. And you mentioned possibly a school.
if that's what the municipality wants and the school boards want, and certainly the other thing, they'll be managed like ground floor grocery stores. You've got to have the retail. The people have to live, work, and shop, and all of that. The master plan is a demonstration plan. It's not fixed. As soon as the determination of the roads and the master developer for that site, all of that will come forward. But the master plan will just guide, the general principles and the mix of uses on that site.
Okay, great.
Thank you. Next question over on this side.
All right. Hi. It was really interesting to see these two presentations back to back because for me it felt like here's the problem and here's the solution. I don't know if it was planned that way, but it worked out pretty well. And in the very beginning of the first presentation, you said that these communities are penalized for building housing. So that seems like a way bigger problem than urban form. Like whether all these office buildings are on the street or in the middle with parking in the front, like, is a little bit irrelevant if this is all office for as far as you can see, right? So you didn't talk at all in your presentation about policy around housing in Silicon Valley, and I know it's very fragmented. So what would it take to get some towers intermixed with those buildings?
I think first and foremost, what it would take is political will, and what it would take is a cultural shift. One of the challenges, we were talking with Stan's team earlier about this, one of the challenges with having local control over all land use decisions is that local agencies answer to local elected officials, and local elected officials answer to local homeowners. And the politics of NIMBYism in the Bay Area is incredibly intense. So if you are a local council member and you go to bat for infill housing in some of the employment areas in Silicon Valley, you may get voted out of office. And you've seen this happen a number of times where there's a very strong resistance to intensification and mixture of those employment areas. There's also movements in favor of more housing, and it's interesting to see the rise of a YIMBY movement in the Bay Area that is also showing up at the hearings. So in some ways, there's a little bit more balance in the discourse right now about it. Many of the companies, in collaboration with the cities, and sometimes in conflict with the cities, are trying to build a considerable amount of housing in the vicinity of their campuses.
Facebook, I think, is doing that, right?
Facebook in their next proposal. So there's it always seems to be just around the next bend that, you know, some spectacularly innovative company town will come into being. And for some people, company town is a very bad word and provokes a lot of concerns. And others feel like it's about time these companies kind of pulled their weight in terms of housing their population. They're not allowed to do housing that is exclusive to their employees, which softens the incentive for them. But the challenges are so acute right now that many of, especially the larger companies that have the ability to just have a development wing, you know, it's not your average company that can just be like, all right, we're going to become a major transit provider in the next 6 months because our people can't get to work, or, oh, we're going to build 10,000 housing units. But if you're Google, if you're Facebook, you actually can throw that kind of resources around. And there's, the local politics of that are very strong. A lot of people are very skeptical of that. A lot of people have a lot of concerns about the impacts of what that growth will be. And frankly, in the Bay Area, there's and in California in general, there's a lot of benefit that accrues to homeowners from the scarcity of housing. So it's not like people are consciously saying, oh, my house is a piggy bank because of Proposition 13, which caps property taxes and just runs up the cost of property. So I'm going to, fight housing to build my nest egg. It's not as direct as that, but there are a lot of people that are doing just fine thanks to our tax structure, and they got in and bought a house 30, 40 years ago. And there's a real generational divide where younger people who might be doing quite well economically by national standards cannot find a place to live, and they're starting to become engaged in the planning process and to demand more housing. So that is playing itself out in the political realm. I think there's an increasing understanding of the severity of the problem and the need to actually start producing a lot more housing 20 years ago. If not 20 years ago, then tomorrow.
Okay. Thank you. We have a number of people, which is great, looking, wanting to ask questions. So let's try and keep the questions short and the answers short. Next question.
Hi, I'm Peter Thorne. I have to say that I'm kind of amused by the whole concept of recreating the company town coming from a pulp and paper mining town back east. With regards to transit, one of the issues that seems to come up is quote-unquote, only poor people take transit, and that's one of the resistances that I think we encounter in getting people onto transit, getting people into active modes of transport, because, you know, if I'm rich and successful, I must have a car. So that's the issue for Benjamin. With regards to Tunney's, you've got StatsCan there. StatsCan can tell you what the pressure is or what the breakpoint is for housing in terms of people in danger of losing their housing. Basically, what I would like to see, 25% of those units, 35% decile for affordability, with a covenant to the purchaser that you are required to do this.
Thank you.
Okay. On the transit thing, I would just say, yes, exactly. That's a huge cultural problem, especially in California. And we need to get over it.
Next question over here.
Yes, very interesting Tunney's pasture development. I guess one of the questions, though, that I'd appreciate your thoughts on is the development of the riverfront for uses. Has any consideration been given to development of the riverfront?
I'm sorry.
I guess further up from Westboro Beach up to Pinecrest Creek, I hope to have some significant development there, but I don't know of anything Tunney's pasture up to the bridge.
Just as an agency, as a federal agency that is involved, the NCC have a draft Sir John A. McDonald Riverfront Plan, which I think they have on their website.
Yeah.
And that plan is in draft, and I understand it potentially may go to the Board of Directors in June of this year for approval. If you look at that plan, there are a number of uses that are proposed along that riverfront corridor, and I think it's a very exciting plan. You know, one of the things they're going to look at doing is trying to pull the parkway, the road structure back, provide a lot more land right at the water's edge for activities, for cycling. I think it's a very thoughtful plan. It'll complement Tunney's Pasture Master Plan and the people who live at Tunney's in the future, and I think but if you're interested, works for NCC. Well,
the riverfront itself is owned by the National Capital Commission and not by Public Services and Procurement Canada. So the master plan and the uses for the riverfront rests with the NCC. Yes. So basically the NCC's master plan that we're working on right now will determine the direction that we're proposing for uses along the riverfront, all the while with the stated and intended goal that the riverfront stays in public hands and not in private hands.
Sure. Bonjour, j'avais juste une question par rapport au master plan of the pré-tourney. Alors, dans le fond, comment vous allez harmoniser le design de la ville par rapport au les édifices gouvernementaux.
Est-ce que vous pouvez le répéter juste encore une fois?
OK. Comment vous allez harmoniser le design de la ville en général comparativement aux édifices fédéraux?
OK. How are you going to harmonize the city's design plans and the city's design with the federal buildings. With the, so how is the Tunney's Pasture Master Plan going to coordinate and work with the cities? I mean, you said that it's part of the new...
Yes. When we prepared the master plan and went through that four-year process, we worked very closely with the city. The city, at the same time that we were doing our master plan in the area around Tunney's Pasture, there's an awful lot of condominium development on Parkdale, and it sparked a Scott Street community design plan. And that plan went through a whole public process. At the same time, our Tunney's Pasture master plan was going through a public process. And all of the open space components and all the parks and all the plazas and everything else were incorporated into the Scott Street Community Design Plan, which was approved by City Council. And the uses in the master plan for Tunney's Pasture also were incorporated into the city's planning documents. So we worked very closely over that 4 years with the city on the design and the inclusion of Tunney's Pasture master plan in the city's planning documents as well. Just on another outside of Tunney's, we have a couple of other larger federal nodes. We have another one called 530 Trombley Road, which is across from the Salarat shopping plaza. It was an old MTO regional garage. It's about 30 acres of land. We went through and prepared a conceptual development plan as a mixed-use plan for that site. We worked with the city. The city went through, if you can recall a few years back, transit-orientated development plans along their new LRT lines. One of them was the Salarat TOD plan. All of our property was in that catchment area, and it was all included within the city's plan, and all of zoning and official plan policies are all in place for another node that we already. So in that case, they did the public consultation on it, and it was included in their documents at the time. So worked very closely with the city.
Okay. Thank you. Next question.
Hi. Thank you. So I work at Tunney's Pasture right now, and I live downtown. And I find that there actually is a lot of vitality in on the Tunney's Pasture campus on weekdays when people are working. You go out at lunch, people are playing soccer, volleyball, going on walks. It's great. The problem is after 5 p.m. and on weekends, it's a ghost town and no one's there. But I think a lot about how downtown in Ottawa, we have the same issue where if you walk down, say, Slater on a Saturday morning, it's similarly as dead, because even if you have residential and you have retail, that retail closes at 5 p.m. on Friday and doesn't open again until 7 a.m. on Monday. So how do you avoid Tunney's Pasture becoming similarly like a ghost town on weekends?
3,500 units of housing.
Yes, exactly.
But like downtown, you have housing as well, right?
But
I don't think that you have as much housing. And one of the issues that you can say the same, people talk about Spark Street in particular, and the city is working right now on a new master plan for Spark Street, and the NCC is participating, and so are other groups. The first condominium on Spark Street is under construction right now. So yes, there is residential in downtown Ottawa, but it is on the outskirts of the CBD. It's in Centertown and further down Elgin. Right in the core, there's not a lot of residential, I think. And the other thing is the restaurants and the after school activities that will go on, hopefully, when the market study is done and everything, that it will be a draw and people will come to Tunney's Pasture. I mean, I'm talking, I wasn't involved in it, but I would assume that when the development occurs and they determine which type of mix of retail and whatever is going to go in there, if there is restaurants, these are going to be restaurants that are going to stay open. I mean, you'll notice like on Spark Street, there is a difference now that there are some more restaurants and and quote-unquote bar restaurants, so there's a little bit more nightlife than there was previously. But you're right. I mean, these are things that we're faced with, and we don't have a downtown movie theater, and they all closed down. So in a way, I understand what you're saying, but I think that that's going to come down to, and Tunney's Pasture is right on the transit line. It's not far from Westboro, which is thriving, and so I think that all of that will combine to create a more innovative and healthy environment. But
you know, I think you're absolutely right, Stan. I think we do have the right mix of residential, employment, retail, recreational facilities, and market studies will be done in advance to determine at the time, as we develop it in phases, what are the appropriate mixes. I think it'll be an absolutely vibrant, great place to live, and probably from a federal perspective, but a very good, complete community. So.
This discussion suggests to me that, especially given that it will take some time for the development to roll out and to get those bodies on the street, but the light rail's opening, what, next year?
This fall.
It would be a very interesting place to think about some tactical urbanism to, you know, if you put a beer garden at the light rail station on one of those underdeveloped lots and just fenced it off, and after work, those people flowing down towards the rail could start to gather there. It starts to shift the psychology of the place. If you think this is a place that is dead, I'm going to get out of here. It takes a while to break that, and you can break it before you actually get the full rollout of the development by starting to activate it as part of the development process.
Yeah, we love tactical urbanism. We've had Mike Leiden here also in the Urbanism Lab. It's sometimes difficult within a bureaucracy to have tactical urbanism, but we try.
I certainly agree on a personal basis about having the beer garden, but I don't know if I don't know if I could recommend it to my minister or assistant deputy minister.
Thank you.
Okay, we've got 5 minutes left, so let's try and get everybody in.
Okay. This is a design intersection question. The corporate campuses have been highly influential in changing interior design practices. And the model for interior design in those big four plates has just transformed the workplace. So I'm wondering, given that, what does that mean for the built form that's following on from that, if that interior design trend has gone viral?
Well, so if you imagine sort of the Portland grid, which is one of the poster children, although Ottawa has a very tight grid as well, and that being one of the fundamental attributes of a walkable environment, you can't put a 400,000-foot square foot floor plate on that and continue to have that pedestrian network. So there's a fundamental tension right there. You know, you can put 100,000 square foot floor plate on a tight urban block and it works. So that's a pretty big floor plate. And I think it's a question of how extreme you want to get. You also have had something of a backlash against the sort of extreme open office happening. There's a lot of folks that are frustrated by the experience of working in open offices, and that doesn't mean they want to go back to sort of walled off corridor offices either, but you could, you know, come back from the brink a little bit, and I think that will help lessen the pressure put on the external building envelope as well.
Thank you. Question.
Thank you for your presentations. Interesting plans that PWGSC has for Tunney's Pasture. Just wondering, the tougher nuts to crack, the two failed high-tech campuses, Nortel and Uniphase, which are now inhabited by federal government departments. I mean, really, those pictures of those could have gone into Benjamin's slide deck very easily. Just if you have any thoughts on what might be done there.
Well, I don't know about Uniphase. The Nortel campus, as everybody knows, is being prepared for the headquarters for the Department of National Defense, and they are working on there's a master plan currently, and there's working on a master plan for the growth of that campus, which I don't know whether we have any information that we can share at this point.
Yeah, I don't think we have any information on it at all.
talk about your security issues.
It's national defense.
Yeah, exactly. One thing I wanted to mention that we recommend in the corporate campus report is thinking about a privacy gradient. One of the classic books in urban design is Defensible Space by Oscar Newman, which some of you may know, that really described why the towers in the park model was so problematic because the collision between public and private was so dramatic. And a traditional urban street has a gradient from public to private through front stoops and steps and things. And you can apply that to a much larger site if you think about what areas of your use need to be absolutely private and secure versus what elements are more on the edge, and then complementary uses that can actually interact with the public street. You can build that gradient into a much larger campus as well. It's not just for houses, and it's a useful concept, I think.
Okay.
Okay.
Best for last.
Thank you for your work here, and I appreciate what the lab is doing. I'm Phil Stafford from Bloomington, Indiana. I've been at the IMCL conference all week, and so I'm a little slap happy at this point. I don't think my question will require a long answer. I wonder if we're overcrediting the decision makers. I was referring to Ben's four factors in form and location choices, and I wonder if we're overcrediting the economic rationality of the people that make these decisions. I remember, I think it was Holly White, a number of years ago, did a study on where corporate headquarters were being located in the New York City area. And he looked at a number of factors and included that the primary predictor of where the corporate headquarters would locate was where the CEO lived. Okay? When you mentioned Steve Jobs and his brainstorm to create that building, it made me think maybe there's a simple solution. I don't know the name of Steve Jobs' successor. I'm sure somebody here does.
Tim Cook.
Steve Cook? Oh.
Tim Cook.
Tim Cook, okay. So maybe the solution is just to slap him in the face and say, stop doing that. A more serious question might be...
I'll let you do that.
Yeah. More serious question would be, a simple solution might be to unionize the tech workforce. So give the power to that population. Think of them as a collective rather than individual automatons, although albeit creative ones.
All right. Thank you very much on that point. Thank you all for coming. Merci d'être venu ce soir. Please check our website for our next and last event of the season, which will be in June, celebrating National Indigenous Peoples Day. Donc, vérifiez sur notre site web pour notre prochain événement en juin. Alors, merci d'être venu. Merci et bonsoir. Thank you.